degrees on it, on forgiveness. We don't, you know, I've been preaching on forgiveness, and I think a lot of people don't understand the simplicity and some of the things that we need to forgive, that we kind of overlook, that we just kind of carry along as baggage. So I think we'll have fun with that subject today, because Vias Vito and Frank Marklin. Did you drop your watch here, Henry?
I don't think so.
Boy, it sounds like you broke your crystal. And Don and Carol Hughes are here with us as our teachers this week, and they're just coming in the living room now. They finally arrived. I think they've been coming by stagecoach. But we're going to have a good program today. How you doing?
I'm doing fine, Jim. And when you
you recuperated from all your travels?
Yes, finally. I finally got to sleep enough to where I'm awake again. We had quite a couple 2 weeks, didn't we? We had a very busy 2 weeks.
We really have.
And I was in Washington for a whole week.
More people tell me they saw you on the Larry King show.
Yeah.
Everywhere I've been, I've had people come up
I
and
have
say
too.
That they watched that show.
That was kind of scary. But I enjoyed it. I enjoyed meeting Larry King, and yeah. I enjoyed being with him.
They used to throw the Christians to the lions. Now they just throw them to the media. You know, it's kind of this is the quietest audience.
This is a quiet audience for so many people.
Well, we've got another group
did
next
somebody
door.
Did scare them? Bob, did you scare the audience today?
Why?
What was it? That light blowing up.
Oh, is that
scare them? Scared them. They're smiling, though. They are smiling, so they're a friendly group. See, they're friendly.
Well. We've got a whole group next door in the barn, and if you all don't start, you know...
Oh, you wouldn't. You wouldn't trade groups.
Yep.
Oh, no.
They come over here, and you go over there.
How many were over there in the barn yesterday? Oh, no.
Oh,
that's good. So they got
in
today. That's
my
good.
My man, we had a crowd over there yesterday.
We did.
Then, that many people were over there.
Yeah.
So, over 300, you say? Oh, my lands, that's terrible.
We need a bigger television studio.
Well, we're building one.
I know.
We're going to build a 5,000-seat studio along with our new...
I know.
Our new church. The church will seat 30,000 people.
Yeah. That's going to be wonderful. It'll really be fun, Jim, when we can all get together. It seems like every time we do something in this ministry, we never build it quite big enough.
No, we don't.
We never and I hope this one will be big enough.
Have you ever wanted 1 minute on television to say anything you wanted to say to the whole world? I want to go get the easel over here. Talk for a minute.
Oh, all right. Well, what?
You're not talking.
Oh, I was supposed to talk.
Yeah, I just gave you a minute.
Oh, I thought I didn't know what happened. Well, I lost it. I blew the whole thing.
You had a whole minute to say anything you wanted.
And I blew it.
Now it's too late.
Yeah, that's the way it goes.
I mean, you could have made announcements. Or...
Yeah. Oh, well, my show's on strokes today. I could say that. My
your show
party
gives some people strokes. See, they agree.
Oh, dear.
This is a feisty crowd.
They're ready for bear.
But I just wanted to quickly mention this. You know, we're talking about building the
now
new
you've
studio.
You've only got a minute, too.
No. I know, I got 1 minute. We're building, Lord willing, we hope by Christmas to begin the Crystal Palace that was built in London, England
but
in 1851. No. This is a part of the new farm village where Kevin's house is located. This particular first unit is on Lake Caroline, just off of Lake Caroline on the little stream that feeds Lake Caroline, across from the petting zoo barn and the big farm. And the big barn's almost done. It's being painted red right now as we speak. And that farm village where downtown in the old Victorian town, you have to ride horses and buggies. There's no cars allowed in farmland, just around the outskirts where you'll be able to park behind your lodge, but you won't be able to drive inside.
Anybody's ever had a wreck with a horse and buggy?
Oh, I'm sure they have.
You think they used to speed
Annie
with them?
Annie said she had. Annie, you had a wreck with a horse and buggy?
I did, yes.
You did?
On Fifth Avenue in New York.
On Fifth Avenue
in New York? Did you fall out of the buggy, Annie, or what?
Oh, it was beautiful.
It was beautiful.
The wreck?
How old are you, Annie? 80?
I'm past 85 years.
Oh, you're past 85.
Yeah.
So, Annie,
did they give tickets for speeding with the horse and buggy? That's what I want to know.
Oh, it was beautiful.
Yeah. Annie, did they just... When you were a little girl, they had horse and buggy?
Sure they did.
Yeah.
I was born in New York City.
Yeah, have you gotten adjusted?
Oh,
you've seen it all. Have you been? Have you gotten adjusted to cars yet?
Well,
a little bit, huh? All right. All right. We'll talk to Annie later. But what we wanted to say is the response to the family bunkhouse, and this is for families only. And so if you would like to have a Family Heritage Club membership, we thought they would last maybe 30 days before all of the bunkhouses are gone. All the lifetime membership from the tower is gone. All the lifetime membership from the grand's gone. And so many people are coming to Heritage USA. We figured last week we had 20,000 people at the water park alone here at Heritage USA. And it's just moving forward. And wonderful offers for the Christian family like this will never last and won't be able to be repeated, something like this. For $500 gift to the ministry to help us stay on the air and to help us build and do all things growing, we want to let you stay in a family bunkhouse every year for 3 days and two nights every year the rest of your life. There's nothing like it. It sleeps six, but you have to be there, and you can have four of your relatives come. It can be grandma or your aunt or your children, but you must be there because this is for the family. This is not a tourist cabin for whosoever will. This is a family club membership at Heritage USA for a gift of $500. So many families, especially younger families, could not afford really to donate $1,000. And so we're trying to do something so everyone can be involved with your own Christian retreat center here, Heritage USA, in a place that's so much going on and a lot of excitement. And if you want to put on a credit card, if you want to guarantee you have it, we have our operator standing by right now at 1-704-554-6000. Now, what we've done, Tammy, is we have made a little family package of this so the family can have, the young family with two or three children can have a family vacation the rest of your life for only a $500 gift to the work of the Lord. And it's just something really exciting. And what we're going to do is, included in your family club membership, you will have free use of many, many things at Heritage USA. For instance, the family center, roller skating. Your children will be able to roller skate free instead of paying an admission. You'll have the shuffleboard will be free, the horseshoes, the putt-putt golf, roller skating, the tennis court, the swimming pool at Recreation Village, the swimming pool at Buffalo Park. And this is a little group of things that, will be soon people will have to pay to use the tennis court because we have to regulate it somehow. But you that are in the Family Heritage Club will have a little package of activities that we're listing there that you will have as well as a bonus, as well as having free lodging. And there's sleeping for six, there's color television, a table and chairs for you all to sit around in there. And a bathroom with a tub and shower and the whole works. A really nice bathroom and a sink outside at a counter, another dressing counter, so everyone doesn't have to get ready at one sink.
And a full-length mirror, right?
we usually do in honor of Tammy Faye. So if you want a Family Heritage Club membership, you really need to get a hold of us immediately. I thought they would be gone in 30 days. It could be that we will have to close this club down in a week. Yesterday, I opened it to the audience, and they lined up to get the membership, so I know it's really going to happen. So we want you to be a part of Heritage USA, and I didn't mean to get into that too much today.
Let's think. You took more than your minute, though.
Yeah, well, I took your
you
minute.
You only gave
you
me
lost.
A minute, and then you took, what, about six?
Why don't you and Sue sing my favorite song, okay?
We'll do it.
All right. Tammy Sue Baker and Tammy Faye Baker have recorded on Tammy Faye's record a duet. And this is their first time to have recorded a duet together, and I'm very pleased. It's one of my favorite songs. And it's sort of what I've been preaching about lately, that we truly are to care one for another. And it says, "Lean on Me." Tammy Faye, Tammy Sue. Thank you. Somebody.
Amen.
To lean on. And
yes.
I'm so glad that we have friends.
Hallelujah.
And I'm glad we have Jesus
to
lean on too, aren't you?
Amen.
If you'd like to have a copy of that record, that is recorded on the Enough is Enough record. And just to look at this cover would be worth giving the $25 for, you know. And we also have all of the words in the sheet music to all these new songs that Tammy has recorded. The Sun Will Shine Again, and No One Ever Cared For Me Like Jesus, Lean On Me, You Are So Beautiful, He's Coming Soon, My God Is Real, Staying Up On The Wall, He'll Do It Again, all the songs that Tammy's singing lately. It's on this songbook. So when you give your $25 gift and you ask for the music, we want to send you either the record or cassette and a gift bonus of the songbook. Now, if you prefer not to have the songbook, Tammy Sue's record is available, and we'd like to give you that then as a bonus, called 16. So you can write today and give your gift of $25 to help us stay on the air, and you can have two cassettes, Tammy Faye and Tammy Sue's new record, or you may have two records, or you may say, I would just like to have Tammy Faye's record and her new songbook, and we'll send that out and say thank you for helping us to stay on the air 24 hours a day with Christian television. So take time to write. If we you know, without you, we have no commercials.
Sure.
So our budget's around $2 million a week. Is that what it is? Yeah.
Ooh.
A week. Shocks me whenever I think of that.
Let's just don't ever say it.
Why don't we go back to $50 a week? It was a lot easier then, wasn't it?
Whoa. It was just as hard to get the 50
then. It was. Uncle Henry remembers. It sure was.
My,
yeah.
Vance. You know, this little song, Lean On Me, it's been around for a long time. And yet it has, I think, a great meaning for those who love the Lord.
It really does, Jim. When I heard it, I'll never forget, I heard it on a commercial. And I just burst out in tears when I heard it, because I thought, man, how wonderful that we have Jesus to lean on. And I usually talk during the song and talk about the fact, and on the album I do, on the fact that we do have Jesus to lean on. We need each other.
Yeah.
But when we fail each other, we always have Jesus to lean on.
Amen.
He's always there.
Amen.
Friend that sticketh closer than a brother. He'll never leave us nor forsake us, the Bible says.
You know, I think in our subject matter today is forgiveness. And we've been preaching on it now for several weeks. The Bible says, for if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you forgive men not their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. And he even goes on to talk about if we judge one another, he says, with what judgment ye measure out, it shall be measured to you again. So here we have a situation that whatever we do for other people, God says you set the standard.
Yeah.
You actually pick your scoop. You know, if you want a big scoop of blessing, you can give out in a big scoop. But if you give a little teaspoonful, you get back measured by however you measure out. And I would like to be one who I have chosen in my life, and I hope it's working. You know, I think sometimes it's a struggle to forgive everyone. And I figure if I can give out a lot of forgiveness, then I'll get forgiveness. If I give out a lot of mercy, then I'll get mercy. Don't you think?
That's scriptural.
Bias Vito is here with us today. Frank Marklin from our workshop team. And Don and Karen Hughes. Here with us today. Carol. Don, it's nice to have you back teaching for us this week. Appreciate it.
Having a good time.
Yeah.
And I heard Carol taught on forgiveness, somebody told me.
This morning.
This day.
This morning. I didn't realize that you'd been doing that.
No, and I mean, Bob Gass came in here yesterday preaching identical scriptures that I've been using. And he'd been off preaching somewhere else, so he hadn't been in tune with what I was doing. So we must all be somewhere where God would have us to be in this matter of forgiveness.
Jim, I think we need to understand something, too. We're instructed in the Word of God to listen what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Mm-hmm.
And if there's a lot of different voices saying the same thing, but we didn't get together and pre-plan that, then the Spirit of God is saying something to the church, and we better listen.
You know, forgiveness isn't an option. You know, forgiveness is not something you can just say, well, I choose, let's say, I'll pick forgiveness, or I'll not, or I'll, let's say, I choose holiness, or I choose this other subject to do. You know, it's not an option. It's not something you can pick and choose. Because the Bible says, but if ye do not forgive, neither will your Father which is in heaven forgive your trespasses. That's Mark 11:26. And Mark 11:25, and when ye stand praying, forgive if ye have aught against any, that your Father also which is in heaven may forgive you your trespasses. So forgiveness, we're finding, is something that's so deeply important that by, I think, every workshop we do, we have to keep going back to forgiveness. It doesn't make any difference if we're doing the men's workshop or the women's workshop or the family workshop or the marriage workshop. The whole pivot point ends up being forgiving.
And forgiveness of three different persons. Forgiveness of a person that's hurt you, forgiveness of yourself, and forgiveness of God for allowing that to happen in your life. Those three persons we always have to cover in forgiveness.
What, Frank, what is the hardest thing you think that people have to forgive? What are some of the top things you have to, I mean, like you say, boy, I'm sick and tired of dealing with this same thing. I wish these people get through their heads. But you have to deal with it almost every time you get into a workshop or in a counseling session. What are some of the basics?
I think number one is yourself. I think that is, it seems like people can even receive, and I know I could understand God forgiving me. You know, when I become a Christian, I knew that was the only way I could get there. And I knew that I was saved, so I could understand God forgiving me, and I could understand other people forgiving me. But there was that constant little nudging all the time that I couldn't get over myself, some of the things that I had done to other people, and especially people that had already died. It was like, you know, I couldn't even go to my mother, you know, and just really, you know, Mother, God forgive me for the rotten things that I did, the embarrassment that I caused you, you know.
But when you're saying the person has the hardest time, of course, we know we have the hardest time with ourselves, but I didn't know it was the most difficult thing to forgive ourselves. I guess I should have known that. But is that would you say that maybe is that the first step to forgiving others? Do you have to forgive yourself first or not?
No, I don't believe you do.
You don't?
No. Very seldom would we ever start out, let's all forgive ourselves. But when we're moving into the forgiveness, then we're talking, you know, now God is agreeing with you right now. This person is forgiven. That's settled. Now, let's settle it between you and God. You know, God has already forgiven you, but you're kind of moving yourself about a half a notch higher than him in the area that says, no, I can't forgive myself.
Forget it.
You know, it's almost a schizophrenic statement there, you know. I'm receiving your forgiveness, but I'm not doing it for myself. Mm-hmm. It's almost a two-way street there immediately. And, Jim, we cannot possibly move into fatherhood God's way, husband, male, mother, wife, woman. Actually, until we start to grow up, you know, that takes adults. And it's that child in us that will always try to hold us back. And I think if we can start getting that child to forgive, then they start growing right before your eyes, right before your eyes.
Well, you really set me up good, because this is where I want to go today. I didn't want to go with forgiving of adultery and forgiving of murder. We understand that. We've been dealing with that in other programs. What I want to get to is she always leaves the top off the toothpaste.
I don't.
No, but I think there we collect. No, we dress in a whole different bathroom. She has her own and I have mine.
Well, he doesn't know if I leave the top off my toothpaste.
The greatest way to stay married.
Hallelujah.
More marriages break up over
the bathroom.
Who's going to use it first and how, when?
Well, I think even the toothpaste companies have become aware of that. They have a little cap that is stationed on the screw top right now, where all you have to do is flip it up.
Well,
you
know? I use this pump kind, so
you don't
have to take the top on or off anymore. I've overcome that great fault.
What that
now.
Does, that kind of takes away one more excuse.
Yeah.
Right.
But now this is where I really want to get to help people with these. They're resentments, but it's unforgiving.
It's
an unforgiving spirit. And so, can you all help me? Think of some of the things. Tammy, you start thinking of some of the things that we could all hold.
Well, I think anything around the house, Jim, we could hold. Really, I do, because I think it starts to wear on the nerves of the other one. You know, husbands would never pick up their clothes, and you think, my Lord, the least they could do, there's a hanger right there. Why couldn't they just hang their clothes up? Jim and I had a real bad fight with that one time. But he got good.
This is not Jim and Tammy confession time.
Another thing is whenever you run out of something in the house, the husband always blames the wife.
Well,
if you're out of milk,
house,
if you're out of toilet tissue, if you're out of soap, it's always the wife's fault. Another one?
Yeah.
I've got another one.
Bob, get a microphone and go on the audience. And let's, you all think of some of the things. What I want to do is get people to the point where we see, you brought this thing up, this childishness. We play childish games. And I think divorce comes many times from the little irritants that
all
just
building
build up.
On one another.
I think in the high 90%. Jim.
Really?
Yeah. Sometimes I shock people when I really say, one night stand, a husband going out on a woman or a woman going out on her husband, either way, very seldom ever leads to a divorce. Now, an affair very well could. But it's this knowing, and I think what happens is many times, I know with this man, if you attack my pride, you know, it's so easy for me to hang on to something then, because it's like if you attack my character, don't attack me for, you know, tell me that you're not going to pick my clothes up, but don't tell me I'm acting like a little boy, because then you get that little boy going, you know?
Yeah.
And I get into that pride that says, it can rot before I'll pick him up, you know? And,
are you lazy slob?
Yeah, lazy slob. Yeah, that character assassination.
Or that's so childish.
Oh,
and
yeah.
What happens is...
Especially when your wife says...
What happens is you already have... Most people have a fairly negative self-image of themselves.
Yes, they do.
Isn't that correct?
Yes.
I mean, as we deal with people, we find out even the most dignified PhD ends up, you find out that he is very insecure inside. Mm-hmm. So if you have the closest one to you reinforcing that you're a dumb cluck, no matter how many PhDs you have, you saying, well, that's true, I am a dumb cluck, but you don't want to be a dumb cluck, and you don't want the one you love reminding you that you are a dumb cluck, mm-hmm. You know.
What's a dumb cluck?
I don't know.
That's a snippy rooster.
I doubt if we have one here.
We don't have one here. We definitely don't have one here.
Jim, you know.
Maybe it's Howard the Duck. I don't know. I heard a movie out by that time.
Carol and I, when we hold our marriage seminars, and we're teaching on marriage here this week, of course, we're trying to tell people, get the fun back in your marriage.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, the couple, while they were dating, they had fun that overlooked faults. Mm-hmm. But when they get married, they cease to have fun and they start looking at the faults. And, you know, of course, if you look at it closely, Adam really blamed God in his statement that, he said, Lord, it's the woman you gave me. And Satan's deception started blaming God immediately. But we always want to blame somebody else.
Yeah.
So Carol and I, we make fun out of the things that that would tend to cause a problem. For example, if I drive, which I do quite often, pass up my turnoff, I say, well, why did you let me do this? You know, why didn't you tell me? And of course, she knows I'm kidding, even though I'm upset with myself. See? But we
put that trait is certain people have real problem with that. They can never accept any blame themselves.
Right.
So they're always mm-hmm. blaming the other person. You know, you made me get angry. You made me do this.
And the other person can never win. Can never win, because if you tell them to turn off here, they get mad. And if you don't tell them to turn off here, they get mad.
And that's very true.
Yeah. It's
no win situation.
Now, we're going to talk about driving stories. Tammy and I will need counseling after this program, by the way.
I think we will too.
We're going to need help.
I'm going home tonight. Yeah.
But now, in the driving problem, Tammy does something to me that bothers me.
What? What do I do?
You tell me I drive like an old man.
Well, you do.
I went to driver's training. You drive with two hands on the wheel. I use turn signals, and I drive the speed limit.
That's the problem. You got to go to the
No, road. You don't say that.
I told her, if you didn't drive like an old baby.
Yes,
right?
Yes, you did.
Say that.
And I always tell her, I said, I've never wrecked you. Yes. You know, and she'll be holding on, and I'm doing this great driving, you know. And she still holds on occasionally, you know, like, you know. And then I get on her all the time because she drives too fast. Is that correct?
Yeah. I have to really
Does that
work
bother
on
you?
That. What? Driving
that,
too fast?
No, that I get on you about that.
Now, show us how you drive.
No, does that bother you when I get
no,
on
honey,
you?
No, honey, it really doesn't, because I know you're doing it for my own
I want
drive.
You to be safe. No, but it bugs me to death when you tell me I drive like an old man.
So you'll have to forgive her, won't you?
I'll try. We'll work on it after the program.
Let's go to the studio audience.
Oh, dear.
Anyway, just raise your hand if you can think of things of irritants that we all do to each other that can build up, that we really got to get over and stop being like that. Just raise your hand, quickly. Raise your hand. Here's a lady right here.
I think in the area of cars, my husband, when I get in and drive the car, you know, the car seat's right up close.
Yes.
And then when he gets in, he's cramped right up, you know. And he always has to ask, you know, I always have to say, oh, honey, will you please forgive me for that, you know.
Does that bug him bad? What?
Oh, yes.
He thinks you ought to set it right back.
Yeah,
front,
he thinks
huh?
that when I get out of the car, I ought to shift it back, you know, for him. I don't think of that. Yeah.
Yeah. Boy, you got back at him today, though. No, but that's, you know, but no, here's a lady right, there's a lady right in front. But that's a good thought.
It is a
You know, because Tammy is 4'10" and... She drives totally up front. Yes.
I think an area of irritation is interrupting each other because it attacks one's pride. If you if you interrupt them and start to tell the story, then they feel that they're not doing an adequate job.
That's yeah. Another
yeah. 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 Do we ever do that to each other? But we're so used to, we just talk at the same time half the time, and so it doesn't really bother us.
That doesn't bother us.
No.
We do pretty good.
But it does bother a lot of people, though. Because it, you know, you steal. Henry's terrible at that. Henry sat on the show one day. I had this guest. Forgive me. I'm going to confess Henry's sins now.
Okay, go ahead. Go ahead.
But
I'll
here this man
you.
Was building his whole story up. And Henry was just sitting there because he knew the story. And he laid the punchline out before the man got to it. But now people will forgive Henry because Henry is known for his jokes and fun and puns, you know. But that irritates a lot of people. Now they didn't get. I don't think they got mad at Henry because Henry is just not easy to get mad at. But if you pull somebody's punchline when they're telling a story, that's almost an unpardonable sin.
It's like you know, Jim. Sometimes children will want to tell you something, and it takes them forever to tell you something. And I think sometimes that'll bug a mom and dad an awful lot because it just takes them forever. And you want to hurry up, get on with what's the end, what do you really want? You know, they go all around the world before they finally tell you they want to go over to Joel's house to sleep overnight. We
yeah.
know that.
Well, daily, my two children come to me.
Oh, yeah.
And if I'm sitting in a chair, they usually come up and put their arms around my neck. And then they just say, hi, Daddy. And when I'm not in a good mood, I say, what do you want? You know, and really, we need to take time to listen to our kids instead of, come on, let's get some more. Let's jump through it.
I have a lady here, Doctor.
Yes.
I'm in trouble.
Well, Bob does something that really bugs me.
Oh, good. I want to hear this.
He never, ever closes the lid on the commode.
Can you top this? Yeah.
What does that do for you?
Do what?
What did you say?
What problem does that cause you?
She drops her jewelry in the commode.
I think she's afraid of the dark.
Yeah. Yeah. You think that's
I think it looks nicer.
You think that's inconsiderate of him?
Well, because he knows I don't like it.
Yeah,
sure.
So he should think about that,
yeah,
right?
That's
well, who's
cool.
going to see it besides me and her?
It's not the seeing it, Bob.
You might get company.
That's true.
Well, if anybody rings the doorbell, the first thing I'll do is run and close the door.
This could injure
we
marriage.
Better move
you
on.
Better go to the next person. Anybody else, raise your hand.
Where? Okay, here's a gentleman. Let's get a
now
man.
Now, you can see how that...
That,
I mean,
that
that's a silly little thing.
Yes.
But you could see that there was some feeling there.
Yeah.
You know, you could see that they were, you know, they could be, we could develop a good fight from there, couldn't we?
There's a lot of things about toilet seats in there.
Well, I remember when commodes didn't have covers. That's how old I am. So I've got to get used to that.
Oh,
we have a gentleman here.
Yeah. First of all, my wife is right with me.
Yes.
We have just celebrated our 30th anniversary.
Wonderful.
I've been through this. Now, I was a bus driver, and I'm going to make it real brief. I've learned to keep the honey in the moon. Bus drivers, sometimes they're knocking off time is unpredictable.
Yeah.
My wife's a good cook. And I believe to eliminate a lot of problems our young folks are running into, especially newlywed, the man of the house, I usually call home and say, Mom, I'll be at a certain time, I'll be home. So that when she's warming the food, when she gets the food ready, the food will be just right when I get there. And this will eliminate a lot of arguments.
Thank you. Yeah, that's good. How many? I wanna take a little poll. I think he hit a real nerve center here. I could tell through the audience. How many women are upset when your husband comes home late for supper, dinner, and he didn't bother to call and let you know? Does that upset you? Wave if it does.
Wave, ladies. Come on, wave
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
Every one of them, mama.
Some are waiting to do it.
Yeah, someone hysterical over that.
Okay, Bob.
You want to take one or two more?
It irritates me when my husband don't close the closet door. He know it bothers me and he leaves it open.
Close the closet door.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
What? Come on now. You folks confess now. What makes you mad?
Well, for 18 years, I've been trying to get my husband to turn his socks right side out before we do the laundry. You don't do it.
I didn't even consider that one.
Come on, real quick, on the aisle. Anybody, just raise your hand real quick. What makes you mad now? Come on, what
are
you
saying? Somebody on the aisle, get ready.
Come on, anybody
here,
else?
Let me get this gentleman.
When I'm driving down the road, every time I come to a crossroad or a stop sign, my wife, she breaks more than I do. I need to put some brakes.
That's Tammy Faye. I threatened at times to put her a whole set of brakes and steering wheel on her side. Get her like a driver's training car. That's what we need. We both can drive at the same time.
Shopping? Yes.
How many men hate to shop with your wife? Now, how many hate it? Just hate
guys,
it? Come on, wave, man. Let's see.
Oh, guys.
See, those men are in hysterics out there over this thing. Is there anybody? There's a lot more, but
let's see what the wife says.
What?
In consideration.
Tammy, I want you to tell what that lady said about me Saturday.
At the flea market?
Yeah, you remember?
Oh,
I hope
sure.
you do. I'll remind you if you didn't.
Oh, at the flea market, this woman came up to me and said, I must be just the luckiest woman in the whole world that my husband would stand there at that hot flea market and shop with me and that you were a wonderful man.
See?
That's what
she said. Hey. Yeah. All right. I guess I had something to that.
All the men are
five out there.
Boy, so see, women understand that, well, that's a great sacrifice.
That was. And I appreciate it, honey.
Lord.
Yeah, wonderful.
No, but did you notice as we talk, and we could go on for hours here and they could give us the things there, do you realize that the things that really irritate them aren't very big at all?
Mm-hmm. And Jim, I think...
Socks inside out?
Yeah, I think the problem...
I've never heard that one. That's,
I think the problem is that you know, though, that the problem isn't all those little things. It's the fact that you have asked your partner or your child, and they know how much you wish they'd do that. And when they refuse to do it, then you think, well, they don't care a thing about my wishes and what I ask, you know. And I think maybe that's the problem there.
But there again, we're assuming. And that's what destroys the relationship.
And the real danger comes. Satan is always around with this seed of bitterness.
Mm-hmm.
And when you nurture these type of things, he'll come along and drop that seed of bitterness in, and the little unforgivenesses nurture it, and it grows up to be a real root of bitterness.
Well, you know, we need to forgive each other. First of all, we got to forgive the toothpaste cap, the socks, the commode seat, the driving problems. We need to forgive those little things all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And if your husband or your wife just can't change, you know, what do we do then with the scripture? It says love covers a multitude of sin.
Or now, hardly even notices when someone does it wrong.
Yeah. So what we're talking about is, you know, if we're to cover sin, why can't we cover the toothpaste cap? Why can't we cover, you know,
a little bad habit,
the grinding your teeth like I have done at times in my sleep that makes her really upset? But I'm asleep and I can't change that. I'm trying.
You could put cotton in there or something in between.
Well, you know,
teeth.
You used to see how irritated it is for me to grind my teeth at night because I was tense. But I don't think I do that anymore.
No, you don't do that anymore.
See,
you
was
must have calmed
maybe
down
I was able
something.
To stop it.
Yeah, you did. You don't
but you know, a lot of times though, we hate each other, get mad at each other, over things that, you know, that you can't change. You know, like you go up and say, "Your nose is ugly," or you know, you know, that's where we get fighting dirty. You know,
right.
You know, I don't want to even invent these things, but they're there. Vi, you help me with it.
That's right. We start attacking
you're
each
just like your mother
person or their character, and it's things that they have no control over what the mother does.
Yeah.
At all. We have to go ahead and choose to move into that forgiveness. Otherwise, we get in a habit of dwelling on the negative. You'll see an older couple that has dropped into a habit of unforgiveness. They dwell only on the negative, and one will pick, the other one picks. Pick, 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 pick. And, you know, you don't like to be around that type of person. But in your own home, if you'll look for the positive, reinforce the positive, and let some of those little nitpicky negatives go, then the person, out of appreciation of moving on the positive, they'll start correcting some of those things their own self. But if you bring it up all the time, it causes them to dig in.
You know, all those little household things just really bother me until one day Jim said to me, "Tammy, what does it really matter? Who sees it but us?" And I got to thinking, who really comes to our home but us? I mean, it's just us there most of the time. And I thought, yeah, who really does see it, and what does it really matter? You know, why am I going to let toothpaste, commodes, socks, clothes destroy something that is so wonderful? It's such a little dumb thing.
If your friends would cease being your friends because your house wasn't perfect, Who needs that kind
that's
of friend?
Who needs that kind
our
of
last
friend?
Marriage principles, we started off with having the husband stand behind the wife and tell of their sweetheart relationship. And those men looked stunned. And then they started remembering, oh, I bragged on this. Oh, I thought that was so wonderful. After they went ahead and talked about all of the wonderful things they saw in that lady in the beginning, I asked, how many of you have talked about any of those things this last week? Not one hand. How many of you have talked about those things in the last month? Not one hand. And they started verbalizing all of those things. We gave them about 5 or 10 minutes just to remember and to brag on the positive things that they saw in her before and then she in him before. And all of those little nitpicky negatives started to drop off. And they got close, they started holding hands, because they remembered what got them together in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
The thing that you talked about, about meeting back in the same measure, you know, if God could help us not to come up with those negative things at the same time, you know, I really have the problem of getting too upset with Mildred because she just comes back with kindness again. And again and again. And I've learned it's kind of foolish to sit and argue with somebody who isn't participating.
Yeah. That's right.
If I don't say this, then I'm
sorry. I have
come to the conclusion that most of the things that we get irritated about somebody else is we are probably either feel like we have to take on their responsibility or we feel they're irresponsible. So we're going to do it for them. If a person's ever to grow up, then they need to be allowed at least a choice in the matter to work on their own responsibility. You could never work on my responsibility. I could never work on yours. But my wife did a greatest thing that probably ever for me, and it used to be a point of irritation, and not too many people's going to move me from coming in and attacking me. But one time I come home, and I noticed things were laying around on the floor, like my socks
my underwear. And the next day, I didn't think too much about it. I thought, well, she hadn't gotten around to it. You know, this went on for 2 or 3 or 4 days, Jim. And maybe it was a whole week. These little droppings everywhere. And I said, are you on strike? You know, it had, you know. And she said, no, why? I said, well, the house is dirty. She said, the house is not dirty. I've cleaned every inch of this house. I said, what's that? She said, oh, that's yours. And kept walking. Well, I wasn't threatened all of a sudden. I truly seen that was my mess. And even to this day, and I am not a neat, neat person, but most of the time, either at night or in the morning, I will take my underwear, my socks, wherever I might drop them. And I had no idea how many places I did drop them. But it gave me a chance to grow up.
Very good. It really did. I think in forgiveness, it's a choice.
Yeah, right.
I really believe everything in life is a choice. And you have to begin to say, I choose to forgive. Mm-hmm. I choose to forgive. And, you know, this law of what you give out comes back, the law of sowing and reaping. If you start fighting with your mate, then they want to throw something back at you.
Mm-hmm.
And then you throw something back, and then back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, back, and then you're in a this vicious, hot or cold war.
Well, Jim, you remember the old saying, it takes two to tango, it takes two to tangle.
It sure does,
it,
right.
It does. And you have to choose, you know, to be kind. And you can let your wife or your husband or your children or whatever irritate you until you just become obnoxious yourself, or you can begin to pull back and pull back and pull back. And I think as people move back into a good marriage where maybe things have gone bad, you do this not overnight. It doesn't just, you know, it doesn't turn, you know, all the way from sour marriage to a beautiful marriage overnight. You begin to work on it together, and I know that sounds trite, but you begin to do that. And, you know, the kinder Tammy is to me, the kinder I want to be to her, and vice versa. And I think that is such a key.
Yeah, I think a lot of times when we are angry with somebody else, I used to be the kind of person that the first time I would meet somebody, I'd make up my mind if I was going to like them or not. So consequently, I was judging by their outward appearance.
Yeah.
And the Lord showed me one time, look at the people that you don't like the first time. And they were just like me. So sometimes I found out that when I was flashing out at Don for the stool lid and things like that, in him, it was really because I was unhappy with myself and the things in my life that I had never judged. And when our marriage got good, it's when I forgot about what he did and judged me. And he did the same thing. Then our marriage got good. One lady in California told me she divorced her husband because she didn't like the way he smacked his food.
Yeah.
You know, and I thought, how trivial.
Yeah.
You know,
well, you quit putting the responsibility of your happiness on the other person. You take the responsibility for your own self, your own happiness.
But what she said first, she said she used to have an ability, or, you know, to judge people, which is a false ability, by
mm-hmm.
the way,
mm-hmm.
Because you look at somebody and say, well, I just don't like that person. You know, how many times have we really misjudged somebody? You know,
sure.
I used to misjudge congregations sometimes. You know, I'd look at them, they all look so mean. And, it happens. And after the church, they come up to me, the same person that scowled at me during the entire sermon, come and said, oh, Jim, God bless you. I just loved your sermon. You know, I'm going through hell, but oh, it was so wonderful to be here. And, you know, and I had to tell myself good, positive things. Like, these people wouldn't come to my church if they didn't want to hear me preach.
Uh-huh.
They didn't come to scowl mm-hmm. at me. You know, these people aren't here at Heritage because they want to hassle me. You know, why would they come here to hassle me? I mean, they got to go hassle somebody else. No, but I mean, they come here because they made an effort to be
yes.
here. And the enemy can put great evil thoughts in your mind.
Taking your insecurity.
About, yeah. you know, and Tammy and I were the worst. I'll confess for both of us again. At trying to read each other.
Yeah.
Trying to read body movements or, mm-hmm. you know, just saying, you know, I can tell the way you're holding your eyebrow up that you don't really mean what you're saying or something, you know. And that was the killer.
Well,
and they almost had to beat me to death to get me out of it.
Yeah.
You did. Remember, you guys did. You,
yeah.
you almost. You
remember how hard-headed
almost.
You were. Yeah.
yeah.
It's the example of the glass. It's either half full or it's half empty. Mm-hmm. It's however you choose to look at it. If you're moving for the positive, it's half full. If you're moving for the negative, oh, it's half empty.
Jim, there's got to be communication brought back into the marriage.
Yes.
Now, there was a time several years ago that Carol and I had lost communication because of our activity for the Lord, our busyness. And, of course, problems began to come in. So we decided we were going to begin to communicate. But that was difficult.
Oh, yeah.
It was that idea about, yeah, I say, well, you know, you did, yeah, but you. See? And we had to, it took time. But you know, if we'll apply the principles of God in these areas,
right.
This thing, we've got the best marriage we've ever had.
Yeah.
And we're nearing 30 years of marriage.
Mm.
And out of that, Carol was able to write her book on the God kind of marriage that has just helped multitudes across the lands. And
I think there again, it's growing up. I think the whole thing is growing up in the Lord, growing up as a person, not remaining a child in your thoughts.
And if you and want
the other person grow up.
Yes. Yes.
And if you want happiness, you forgive your mate. You forgive your children. And if you forgive, you will be forgiven. You show mercy, you'll get mercy back. And as we move into this realm of forgiveness, we've talked about a lot of little petty, trite things, but it's the little foxes that spoil the vine. I was just going to Tammy Sue's song, and if you just gave me a countdown, it's too late. Is that correct? All right, here's Tammy Sue to sing one of the songs from her brand new record.
She said, "We love you." That was nice.